this time around for The Amazing Spider-Man 2, I wanted to create a score that both had the sort of theatrical dimension of a big movie score, but I also wanted to have a contemporary flavor. And so I called upon Zimmer, who I've, you know, like everybody else in the universe, I'm a huge fan of Hans. What I'm trying to do when I make a movie is connect the audience to the characters. And you want to feel what they feel. And if you don't understand that, if you don't feel that, then you lose the audience and they kind of recoil.
There's more room on the sideline, folks. Please, I got blueprints here. Little help.
The music really tells the story of the villain in a very specific way. Max Dillon is a character who is, let's say, he lives in the shadows. People don't pay attention to him the way that he feels like they should, and he's got that anger in him, and he's got that frustration, and there's that, you know, that feeling of tension, and every time he talks, somebody interrupts him, so he never gets to finish.
But it's my birthday. Everybody else is leaving. Why do I have to stay?
Because you're special,
Smythe. I mean, Mr. Smythe.
Happy birthday.
And that something, that anger, is building up in him, and the music really had to tell that story. You know, that's kind of was the foundation of what played throughout the score whenever Electro came on screen. All the different amazing musicians contributed a different layer to the music, and you know, when it came to Electro, of course he's an electronic monster. He feeds off electricity, and there's that electrocuted kind of energy, and I wanted to have that shocking kind of dubstep thing. I wanted something that would, you know, you could play at a rave, that would be electrifying, that like would make Skrillex want to retire. You know, I wanted to have that really forward-thinking EDM electronic music. And Hans was like, yes, this is great. Okay, yeah. You know, he's like, so he got really into that idea. He's like, I have the perfect thing. He came back 2 weeks later after I told him, like, electric. He's like, yeah, I've got the electrics. It's going to be amazing. And he came in and he played a 17th century opera written by Purcell. And that was not electric at all. But there was that pulsating, bump, bump, bump. It's called the Cold Song. And it was about a creature that had been summoned from the cold. And only wanted to return to it, so his voice was freezing, and he had that physical, physiological response to the music. He was actually, you could feel it in the music, you could feel that shivering. Hans interpreted that as being electrocuted, as that pulsating feeling when you connect yourself to electricity and you're being rocketed or shocked to death. And that became the foundation.
Whoa, look who's here. Spidey. How was your morning?
You don't hear clarinets weirdly in big scores as much anymore, but I think it's a beautiful, sonorous, really wonderful, warm texture. And we gave it to the villain. You know, we gave it to the bad guy, which I think was a kind of a fun way to humanize that character. So that was the foundation. And then, you know, we were trying to figure out more nuance to it, and Pharrell had really tracked and really invested in Electro's story. He wanted to bring out some very, wanted to bring that out more, and he knows Jamie, and he wanted to work with that. So Jamie sort of walked this line between, you know, madness and pathos, and this psychosis, and some really real feeling, and we were trying to hint at the villainy that the character will eventually, the madness that's going to explode in the character. And he had written out all these different lyrics from the song, and it was voices. It was the voices inside Max's head, and that became the sort of subliminal suggestion from the very beginning of what of his character.
Something's happening, oh my goodness, agony is grabbing me, my pulse is racing, this is paranoia, Spider-Man.
That was the beginning of the voices inside of his head. And then what we did, a guy named Dom in the studio took those lyrics and spoke them, whispered them into a sound box, condensed them, programmed them, repeated them, tuned them, and that gave us the voices that became the next layer of the Electro suite, which sounded like this.
Small kind things that you do for people. I
know what they say about you in the press, but it doesn't matter to me because I know the real you.
In a very real way, the score and the lyrics and the voices become a part of the storytelling. They're not just atmosphere. They're a part of the character. They're literally a part of the character. They're literally a dimension of what he's hearing and what he's feeling. And that's what's kind of, I think, magical about music, is that it was done after the fact, and it was about Pharrell and Hans and those guys being in tune with the character and trying to exploit things that they felt were there but needed accentuating. Johnny developed an idea that added another kind of layer to the music, kind of had that creeping, crawling texture to it. It felt like, you know, one of those electricity balls, one of the Tesla coils that would, you'd see the energy sort of floating around and the electricity crawling along a sphere, and there was something very visual about it. And then you incorporate all those things and you get this. We still needed a little more force, because electro is becoming a little bit dangerous, and you want that power, that gristle, to move forward. And then Mike Einzinger came in, took all the strings off his guitar, strung them entirely with E strings, and started jamming and wailing on it. And basically, what Mike was doing was playing the first few notes of Itsy Bitsy Spider, but he was playing it in a minor key. So that sweet little nursery rhyme, if you drop the third, it comes into this more sinister, evil version of it. Then we sort of mix that layer into it. It's a moment of birth. He's slightly unconscious before, and then he comes out of the Jumbotron, where he's been slammed into by Spider-Man, and he starts to float, which you've never seen him float before, and the bolts of electricity are growing inside of his hands, and he becomes the villain in a way that he was always meant to be. So much of the power you feel in the cinema comes from music and comes from sound, and I am fascinated by the intersection between sound effects and score, and when those things combine and when you are immersed in that world, there's something transformative, and it transports you into some different kind of universe, and that was the intention all along.